Hey guys, Ryan coming to you from downtown Medford. It is Thursday of Passion Week, or maybe you've heard it stated that it's Holy Week. That's true as well. Holy Week, Passion Week, it just means the week leading up to Easter Sunday when we celebrate the risen King. And so tonight we will not have our Thursday night live study. Instead, we are going to have a gathering tomorrow online, Facebook and YouTube, 6:30 p.m. for our Good Friday service. And we will remember the work of the cross. We will remember what Jesus has done in giving up his life for us. We will remember the gift of the Father giving his Son for that purpose. And that's going to be a sweet time for us to do together. That will be streaming live from the sanctuary tomorrow night, 6:30 p.m. on Facebook and YouTube. And then, of course, that will lead us into Easter Sunday, where we have this great celebration planned for us to just rejoice in the risen King. And so that's what we're going to do 10:30 a.m. Sunday morning on Facebook and YouTube as well. I can't wait to join you guys for those gatherings. As we were walking through this week, all of us just kind of learning of the news and things that are happening and taking place. In fact, yesterday, Governor Brown declared that the school year would be officially done, that there would no longer be any hope of school starting back up. And with it, the sports of the spring high school athletes have been canceled as well. And so there's just this heaviness of some finality of these decisions that are being made. And then again, many of you this week have just worked through different issues and struggles in regards to how your job is going and how you're providing and all these things. And we look around and the world seems like it is just gone crazy. Like, I've heard that phrase more than ever this last like 3 week stretch. It's like, this is just crazy. Can you believe what's happening? And we don't. We just, what is going on? And we don't know what to do many times. And I was thinking about Jesus's life leading up to the cross. Because if you were to look from the outside at what was happening in his life, you would think just that. You would think, what has gone wrong? God's plan has gone off the rails. There's no way that this is part of God's plan. Like, you look around at our world right now and what's happening and how things are going, and you go, man, how is this gonna fit into God's plan? What is going on? And this was happening with Jesus there as he was gathered in the upper room with his disciples, and he's talking with them, he's having his last meal with them, and he kind of mentions this. He drops this bomb of like, hey, one of you will betray me. And he's looking at Judas. He's sitting there, and Judas knows he's the one that has betrayed him. And the rest of them are like, what? Who would do that? And then a little bit later in their meal, they start to argue about who's the greatest. Really? Like, there's 13 people in that room, and Jesus is one of them. And there's argument about who the greatest is. But the disciples, that's just kind of par for the course for them. That's what they did. And Jesus is there, and then he goes into the Garden of Gethsemane and he prays to the Father. He asked Peter, James, and John if they can stay awake and watch and pray with him. And he comes back and finds them just asleep, and he's like, you guys couldn't even stay awake for a little bit? What is going on here? And then Judas comes walking into the garden with these chief priests and soldiers, these religious leaders and authority figures. And it's about to get really bad for Jesus. Things are not going to go well. And from the outside looking in, you can look at that and think, what is happening? God's plan, this cannot be God's plan. But when you read scripture, you realize, yeah, it all fit into God's plan. There's this view of the world that many people have, and it's a view that doesn't include God as being in control or God as having sovereignty over things underneath him. In fact, H.G. Wells, that British author, that novelist, famously of War of the Worlds, you've probably heard of that one. Well, this is what he wrote. He was an atheist, and this is what he wrote about life. He said, the world is like a great stage production directed and managed by God. As the curtain rises, the set is perfect, a treat to every eye. The characters are resplendent. Everything goes well until the leading man steps on the hem of the leading lady's gown, causing her to trip over a chair, which knocks over a lamp, which pushes the table into the wall, which in turn knocks over the scenery, which brings everything down on the head of the actors. Meanwhile, behind the scenes, God, the producer, is running around, shouting orders, pulling strings, trying desperately to restore order from chaos, but alas, he is unable to do so. Wow. So that's H.G. Wells' view of God. And that's a sad view of God. And that's a sad view of life in the world, because that's a view that has no hope. We, of course, hold a different view because of what Scripture says and because of the experience that we've had in our life, where we see that God is on the throne. God is in control. And so we trust in Him in these times. But put yourself there in the garden, there on that Passion Week leading up to the cross. You were there with Jesus, and He's praying. He's just announced someone will betray Him. He's announced too in this kind of cryptic way about remembering His body with the bread and His blood with the cup. And they're wondering, what does this all mean? And He's predicted His death to them multiple times leading up to this. And there they are in the garden. And then He looks up in Luke chapter 24. And He looks up, and in verse 47, it says this. Luke chapter 22. It says this: while He was speaking, this is Jesus there in the garden, a crowd, and the man called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He drew near to Jesus to kiss Him. This crowd with Judas came. But Jesus said to him, Judas, would you betray the Son of Man with a kiss? And when those who were around Him saw that what would follow, they said, Lord, shall we strike with the sword? And one of them, we know from other accounts it's Peter, struck the servant of the high priest and cut off his right ear. But Jesus said, no more of this. Jesus, in the midst of this chaotic situation, how chaotic is this? They're in the garden. Jesus is praying. He's asking His friends to watch and to pray. They fall asleep. And then comes another of their friends with soldiers and religious authorities to take Jesus away and imprison Him. The scene is chaotic, and Jesus is there, and the disciples, and they're putting it together, no doubt. There's, well, Judas is the one. He's the one. And then Peter pulls out his sword, and he chops off the ear of this servant of one of the chief priests. This scene is out of control. This has gone off the rails, right? Well, here's the deal. God was in complete control. And I love this, because in the midst of all of that chaos and in the midst of that scene, Jesus stops. And it says, as we just read in verse 52 or 51, Jesus said, no more of this. And He touched the ear of the servant and healed him. He literally picked the ear up that was chopped off and put it back on. And then Jesus said to the chief priests and officers of the temple and elders who had come out against Him, have you come out against a robber with swords and clubs? It's interesting. Jesus is saying, you guys are the lawless ones. You're coming after Me with swords and clubs. You don't need swords and clubs to get Me. You're the lawless ones. Verse 53, when I was with you day after day in the temple, you did not lay hands on Me. But this is your hour and the power of darkness. And they seized Him and led Him away and bring Him to the high priest. I love this story, because Jesus is in complete control. There's everything around Him is falling apart from the outside. If you were to look at that, and if you're the disciples, you're thinking, what is happening? Our whole plan is falling apart. Jesus can't be king if He's in jail. Jesus can't be king if He's dead. What is happening? And yet, the whole time, God is in control. All of this chaos, and an ear flies off, and everybody's running around scrambling, and Jesus is in control. He stops, and He says, enough, no more. And He picks up the ear and He puts it back on, and He heals that servant's ear. And then He says, you guys, you could have taken Me at any time earlier, and you didn't. You know why? Because it wasn't yet time. Because I didn't allow you. And then Jesus allows them to take Him away. In fact, He would say later that He would lay down His life. No man could take it from Him. He laid down His life. He gave up His life for us, for you. And that is the hope of this Easter weekend, that Jesus gave up His life, that He sacrificed and gave over His life so that you and I could have the hope that He would beat death, being that perfect sacrifice, and His blood washing away all of our guilt and shame as He was bleeding there on the cross. And then they buried Him in the ground, and 3 days later, He came back to life. He beat death. So He beat death, and He beat sin, and then He offers that to you and me, that we too can be overcomers. We can overcome death and sin. We can overcome fear and shame and guilt and condemnation. We are overcomers because of who our God is. And that is the hope that we have. So I hope this encourages you guys as you consider this Passion Week, what's taking place, as you consider the work that our God has done He's not done working, and this coronavirus has not impeded his progress or his work. God is not slowing down because of this virus. He was not caught off guard. Our God is on the throne, and we follow him, and we follow him to victory. I hope that you guys are anchoring your hope in Jesus, and that you're ready to celebrate the work that Jesus did through the cross and through his resurrection. Love you guys, miss you, and we'll talk to you soon.